Where's Bartosz? I called as I ran towards my friend and swapped in a new MP magazine.
He ran out of the house half an hour ago, he replied, a little out of breath.
What?
I shouted at Dmitry. He flinched at my tone.
And you just let him go?
He insisted hardy. Didn't want me to go with him, he said to placate me, but his face was serious. There was a strange thing with yellow eyes. He said if he doesn't go, we will all die. You could not have stopped him, believe me.
Where did he go?
I asked, as I passed right by Dmitry and slowly stalked to the cabin.
Heading south, where Frank took the undead, he called out to me.
I accelerated my pace, passed by the house, and ran into the trees. Despite the onset of dusk, the wood stood before me like a dark omen of doom. Clutching the MP5 with both hands, I tried to estimate how far Bartosz could have gone in 30 minutes. During our long march here, he had proved to us that he was much tougher than his years suggested. A few undead appeared every now and then, but they posed no real threat. I took down some with the silenced MP and simply walked past others. After 10 minutes of uninterrupted jogging, I took a short breather and looked around for footprints. Reading tracks was just as much a part of Dmitry's training program as combat with simple weapons. Unfortunately, I wasn't as good as I thought and had a hard time finding anything that hinted at any trace of Bartosz. The dead left no clear footprints since they staggered and lurched, dragging their limbs clumsily behind them. Then I found an imprint in the thin snow, which only fell sparsely there because of the trees. It pointed south. I was on the right track. I set my body, now very tired, stubbornly into motion again. Gradually I had to fight for breath, but fear for my friend drove me forward. Suddenly, half a dozen undead came at me from the right. They emerged from the dark undergrowth so quickly that I didn't even have time to shoot. I swerved to the left to avoid running right into their groping hands. A small tree stump hidden by the snow tripped me. I pitched forward. My upper body hit the ground hard and skidded along the frozen forest floor until I slowly came to a halt. After a short moment of shock, I turned on my back, the MP5 trained where I come, and fired blindly at my attackers. They moved unusually fast and were already leaning over me. I waved my rifle around and kept firing until the magazine was empty. After a moment to reorient myself, it turned out that I had only shot two of them in the head, and the others had gotten away with body hits. Two were already standing on their feet again, while the other two crawled towards me on the ground. I was about to reach for my Beretta when one of them grabbed my gun arm and tore at me like crazy. I pulled the hunting knife with my left hand and stabbed the stinking bastard through the eye, deep into his skull. After pulling out the blood-smeared blade, I found that I still couldn't free my right arm. The dead scum still had my arm in a tight grip. The next one bent down to me, had already swapped his bony hands around my throat when I rammed the knife under his chin and into his brain. Fortunately for me, he tipped away to one side. If he had landed on me, his heavy body would have made it impossible for me to defend myself. Unfortunately, I couldn't pull out my knife, and so it slipped out of my hand, along with the undead. The third one, a relatively young woman, crawled to me over my legs, staring at me hatefully and making throaty sounds. I pulled my left knee to my chest until I could place the sole of my boot right into her face. Then I shoved her with a violent thrust and heard the loud crack of her neck before she collapsed. I pushed her off with another kick. The last undead man went to his knees next to me and leaned over me, while I desperately tried to free my right arm. With my left hand, I clutched his neck as his yellow-gray teeth came closer and closer to my face. His hands beat and scratched at me wildly as my strength gradually diminished. Only a few centimeters left, then he would rip a piece of meat out of my cheek and seal my fate. A desperate cry ripped through my clenched teeth as I freed my right arm with a brutal jerk. I grabbed the musty-smelling undead by the hair, pulled him away from my face, and smashed my right knee to his temple. He went to the ground next to me, but was not done yet. Slowly I pulled the Beretta, supported it on my chest because I was too weak to hold it up, and put it to the undead's head as he turned to me. The sound of the silencer, now so familiar to me, sang like a chorus of angels when I shot him in the head. I took deep breaths in and out as I lay on my back like a turtle. looking up at the sky through the crowns of the trees. For a moment, I thought about just staying down, lying peacefully, closing my eyes and just letting fate run its course. Every muscle, every bone hurt, and exhaustion threatened to put my lights out at any moment. Bartosz couldn't possibly still be alive. The sudden thought overcame me. Maybe I should let things be, make my way back home and accept that my friend would never return. At that moment, I heard two shots fired not far away. I rolled clumsily onto my stomach, slowly and painfully pulled myself to my feet and just ran off, although I didn't really know in which direction the shots had come. After a few meters, I stopped, looked around, tried to orient myself to something that could lead me to Bartosz. A third shot shattered the silence. This time, I was alert. The shot came from the south, at most 100 meters away. As fast as I could, I kept running. My legs were getting heavier, as if someone had filled them with lead. Gradually, I reached the place where the shots had come. Just a few more meters, and I would find my friend. I was sure of it. The forest grew increasingly dense, and I had to detour around some rocks that protruded far out of the ground. That cost valuable time, but I had to proceed carefully now to avoid ambush again. With the Beretta trained forward, I slowly circled a man-sized boulder. Another shot, now very near, made my heart skip a beat. A moment later, a bone-chilling cry echoed in the trees and sent a cold shiver down my spine. I knew the voice. I set off again, felt the adrenaline rise, driving me on despite everything. The sprint was brief. After just a few meters, I saw a figure sitting against a tree and pressing his hands to a blood-soaked wound on his neck. It was Bartosz. He was slowly sagging as strength left his body. I carefully stalked over to him, looking around all the while. No one dead far and wide. Who had he shot at, and why couldn't I see a corpse anywhere? When I reached him, I went to my knees. The old man was briefly startled, but then became aware of who was squatting in front of him. I pulled his hands from his neck to assess the extent of the injury. A thin fountain of blood splashed out of the gaping wound. A large piece had been torn from his throat. The look in his eyes told me that he knew what to expect. Suddenly, he grabbed my collar and pulled me close to him.
"Hardy, he's here,"
Bartosz gurgled softly. Blood was already running down the corners of his mouth and into his beard.
"He?" I asked in astonishment. "Who?"
Bartosz gripped me harder as he stared deeply into my eyes.
"The creature."
A noise right behind me made me whirl around, the Beretta at the ready. As I slowly fought my way back to my feet, I tried to see what was out there. Then I saw him. On one of the larger rocks, about 20 meters away, squatted a dark figure on all fours, ready to leap. He looked at me with dark yellow eyes, but only moved his head slightly. It did not seem that he was about to attack. Rather, I had the impression that this creature was trying to assess me. Blood dripped from gunshot wounds that Bartosz had probably inflicted on him, sprinkling the massive rock. Unfortunately, my friend hadn't shot him in the head, probably because the attack had caught him completely by surprise. This was undoubtedly not one of those undead who blindly attacked anyone it saw without thinking. He reminded me more of a predator watching its prey for the right moment to pounce. Then he straightened up, stretched out his chest, held his arms far away from his body, and let out a long, loud scream that reminded me of a somewhat shrill lion's roar. In my ears, it didn't sound like a cry. It was more of a declaration of war. He had just challenged me. I walked straight up to him and fired. Some bullets bounced off the rock with sparks and some hit him, but without any effect. The Beretta was empty, but I continued to hold it towards him, let the magazine slide out of the handle, already had a new one in my free hand, loaded it, and fired again. The creature had long since jumped away and disappeared under the protection of the dark forest when I fired the last round. The stink of powder floated in the air. A bright smoke poured out of the barrel of my gun as I stood close to the rock, trying to spot my opponent.
"You really want to mess with me?"
I shouted into the forest with all my remaining strength. even though I didn't know if he could understand me at all. But I didn't care, either.
I'd think twice about that, pal! I'm not exactly shaking in my shoes here! Come and get me!
I hoped that he would show himself again and let me finish him. In vain. After a long moment in silence, I decided to attend to my friend again. When I turned around, my blood froze to ice. Bartosz was standing on his feet again, and now moved toward me in that all-too-familiar gait. As he stepped out of the shade of the trees and the light of the rising sun lit his body, I saw the pale skin and the vicious look he directed at me. I felt like someone had poured a bucket of ice water over my head, and my muscles just hung from my frame, on the verge of failing completely. Tears shot into my eyes. I sobbed as I looked down and shook my head. I just didn't want to accept what was happening. My friend's moans raised goosebumps while I wrestled with my breathing. From that moment on, everything played out again as if in slow motion. Slowly, very slowly, the magazine slipped out of my still-smoking Beretta and took half an eternity to hit the leaf-covered ground. I inserted my last magazine into the gun, struck the end with the heel of my hand, and heard it lock into place. I worked the pistol slide, and the red dot of the safety caught my eye, indicating that the gun was ready to fire. The sulfurous smell of gunpowder suddenly penetrated my nostrils. The stink of it seemed to be everywhere. I didn't look at Bartosz, who was only a few steps away. Even if I had wanted to, my tears blurred everything in my field of vision. I walked towards him slowly, my gaze fixed on the ground. One step, then a second. My muscles were still functioning. With the third step, I had reached him, passed him by to one side, lifted the gun to the level of his head, and pulled the trigger. Despite the silencer, the bang seemed unbearably loud and reverberated for half an eternity once it ended Bartosz's existence. I walked on and heard the dull impact of his body on the ground behind me. Three steps later, I slumped to my knees, supporting myself on my hands. My arms seemed like toothpicks that threatened to break under my weight. I couldn't open my eyes for the tears. Snot ran from my nose, and I thought I was finally losing my mind. Then I screamed. I wailed, again and again until my throat burned. My voice failed, and I could cry no longer. At dawn, the undead reached the gorge. Frank had been circling over it for some time and could now only marvel at the mass of undead that gradually emerged from the trees. The first walked right over the edge of the gorge and fell from sight. Some found their end upon the sharp-edged outcrops even before they fell further and eventually hit the bottom. At first dozens, then hundreds, followed the others to their final deaths in their total obsession with the helicopter, a pack of lemmings plunging mindlessly toward their destruction, and, in a sense, their redemption as well. The sight horrified Frank, yet it also fascinated him. No one would ever see such a thing again, let alone be the cause of it. The flood of undead seemed to flow without end, rolling like a gray-brown carpet over the snow-white landscape. It would take quite some time for the last one to step over the edge to meet its fate. Frank regretted that he had nothing to eat, nor any strong coffee to invigorate him. He briefly informed Madeline about what was happening. Then he had no choice but to wait patiently until the greatest danger had passed. Madeline confirmed receipt of Frank's report as she walked the last few meters to the beckoning cabin. It was an arduous descent that cost her a lot of time and even more strength. She had not passed the long night, and especially the ride, unscathed. Her hair, once neatly tied back, was a filthy wreck, and a thick strand irritatingly dangled back and forth in front of her face. When she passed the Hummer, she looked at the piled remains of Hardy's massacre for a few heartbeats. At the cabin, Dimitri welcomed her with a steaming cup of coffee. As he handed her the hot drink, he looked around in concern.
"Frank did it. Most followed him," he told Madeline.
She took a quick sip of her coffee and then looked back at the mountain of dead. "Well, depends how you look at it," she said with a sarcastic undertone. Dimitri followed her gaze.
"That was nothing. There were so many, they got in each other's way. What do we do about Hardy and Bartosz? We follow them?"
Madeline took off the M110 rifle hanging from a strap over her shoulder, leaned against the building, and walked back to the steps. There, she took a slightly larger sip of the hot drink and thought about it for some time. Then she pointed south in the direction Hardy had followed his friend. "They went that way, right?" she asked, looking at Dimitri.
"Duh," he answered, went to Madeline, stood next to her, and looked in the same direction. 30 minutes ago, Hardy also went this way. Bartos, an hour ago."
"Should we follow them?" Madeline said, and looked the question at the Russian. Dimitri shook his head slowly.
"Niet. Something is out there. Something worse than undead. Bartos knows. Wanted to go out and take care of it."
Madeline's questioning look gave way to skepticism.
"What are you saying?"
"Bartos warned me. He knew what he was talking about. We must not separate anymore. We don't know how the others are. We should wait for them and make a plan," Dimitri said.
Sitting around and waiting was just as difficult for Madeline as it was for Dimitri, but she trusted his judgment, knew it was based on valuable experience. They decided to get everything ready for their friend's return, unload the Hummer, and prepare a suitable place for everyone to get some sleep. Sleep that they all needed. Frank was on his way back after watching the undead plunge into the gorge for over an hour. He had the amusing thought that at some point they would pile up all the way to the edge and that the rest could walk over them to the other side. He also struggled with fatigue and was looking forward to a warm place where he could just sleep peacefully. In a few minutes, he would reach the cabin, though he would still have to search for a suitable landing site. The persistent snowfall did not make things any better. Even if he found a suitable place among the trees, he could not be certain of the ground. He might land on a frozen pond that would not take the helicopter's weight. Even though he had found his way there with Madeline's help, the area was still unfamiliar territory for him. About a kilometer before their shelter, he found a place to land between tall trees that offered enough space for the large machine. He risked it, landed the bell safely on the small clearing, and hoped that he had really lured all the undead into the gorge. The masses of swirling snow and the noise of the helicopter engine would otherwise attract them in droves. Although only a short distance, the imminent walk he had to take through the forest sat heavily in his gut. So Frank decided to stay in the machine for a few minutes, just to be on the safe side, lest 100 undead suddenly appear and surround him. He checked his MP5 and his P320, took several loaded magazines for both weapons as a precaution, and pulled on his jacket. While the rotor slowly ran down and the snow continued falling in a fine powder, he looked around again. A white, untouched landscape lay all about him. Not one undead could be seen as far as he could tell in the heavy snowfall. He opened the door, got out, and looked around once more. After making sure that no one could just disappear with the helicopter, Frank set off. The high snow slowed him down, making it almost impossible to make progress until he finally made it to the relatively bare ground beneath the trees. He took advantage of the ground and sped up, eager to leave the eerie scene behind quickly as possible. He paused many times whenever he thought he had heard or seen something. His fatigued senses and the cold played macabre pranks that kept him on edge. Behind every tree, every bush, he suspected he could conceal an ambush. He thought of Hardy, suddenly envied him for his strength, his perseverance, his fighting spirit, and because he seemed to be afraid of nothing and no one. He suddenly wished that those qualities would also make him the man he was. But they didn't. He was afraid, which no one could really blame him for, despite the fact that it was not pitch black and he was armed to the teeth. Caught between all these thoughts, Frank realized very late that he had already left the forest behind him and was suddenly standing next to the Humvee. Looking around in puzzlement, he walked past the mountain of slaughtered dead and headed for the cabin. Slowly and clumsily, but with a smile on his face, he trudged up the few steps to the porch, crossed it, and hammered his fist loudly against the massive door. After a few seconds, Dimitri and Madeline opened up. They smiled at the half-frozen newcomer.
"Frank, you look great,"
the slender Russian said, but Frank just did not feel like joking. He pointed to the mountain of dead.
"What happened?" he asked the two of them as he struggled for air.
"That was Hardy," Madeline replied. Well, Frank nodded. He's never been one for half measures.
The two suddenly noticed that Dimitri had become suspiciously quiet and was staring past Frank to the edge of the forest. They followed his gaze, but could not see anything in the heavy snowfall. Dimitri, is everything okay? Madeline said. She had already pulled her weapon out of the holster and unsafed it. Frank went into a crouch and trained the machine gun, ready to fire.
Something is there. Something big, whispered the Russian, who now also held a pistol in his hands. Madeline, you stay. Give us cover. Frank, come with me.
Frank tossed the MP5 at Madeline, drew his own pistol, and followed Dimitri, who had already reached the porch steps. Even at that short distance, Madeline could hardly recognize the two men in the densely falling snow. She followed them to keep them in sight, careful to maintain enough distance and not accidentally shoot one of them. The men approached the place where Dimitri thought he had seen something. The cracking of branches and their heavy steps in the deep in the snow penetrated her. Something big was getting closer. Frank and Dimitri separated and descended into a crouch to reduce their target silhouette. Madeline was now standing in the deep snow, the MP5 trained and ready to eliminate any danger instantly. The outlines of a tall man, moving very clumsily, gradually peeled out of the snow. Then he stood in front of them. It was Hardy, with Bartosz's lifeless body slung over his shoulders. Hardy's dirty gear, blue-tinged face, and his movements made cumbersome by exhaustion made him resemble an undead. But he was alive. Slowly, carefully, he slipped Bartosz to the ground before he collapsed and lay motionless.
What's wrong with you two? Madeline shouted to Dimitri and Frank, who were gazing at Hardy as if he were a ghost. Bring him in before he dies out there!
While the men carried Hardy into the house, Madeline took a closer look at Bartosz. She discovered the bite wound on his neck, too big to have been inflicted by an undead. Then she looked at the dried blood. It covered almost the entire right half of the body. She looked after the man who had already reached the cabin and felt Hardy's loss. She hadn't really gotten to know Bartosz, but she knew how important he had been to Hardy. She too knew how it was to lose people who were very close to you, people who had prepared you for life, protected you, and defended you until the end. She knew that Hardy would need some time to collect himself again and come to terms with what had happened. Time during which she, Frank, and Dimitri would be there for him, just like her friends once had when Madeline lost her loved ones. She looked down at Bartosz again and smiled softly. One thing she had to give Hardy credit for. He hadn't just left his friend out there. He had brought him home.